Welcome to Capitol Preview, a weekly bipartisan discussion with Iowa legislators about the key issues facing our state. Brought to you by Mediacom.
Hi, welcome to another edition of Capitol Preview. My name is Bill Peard. I'm the Executive Vice President of the Iowa Cable and Telecommunications Association. Capitol Preview is a show that we talk to our legislators, both House and Senate, on what's going on and what's important to Iowa. Our guest this morning is Mary Ann Hanusa, District 16 from Council Bluffs, Iowa. She's a Republican, and I appreciate Mary Ann coming in here. Thanks, Mary Ann.
Thank you for inviting me today.
We're just going to go over a couple things. This is kind of a show that's conversational, that kind of tells what you're up to and what's going on up at the Hill. So I'm just going to kind of jump in and ask you, the first question would be, what's the status of the red light camera legislation? I know that's been going on for quite a while, and it's I know they took action on it this year, and so can you kind of give our viewers an idea of what's going on?
Sure. Well, last year the Senate passed two different bills related to this issue. Mm-hmm. One was a total ban of red light cameras across the state. The other one was Senate File 220, which regulated the use of those cameras. This week, the House took up Senate File 220, and an amendment was added to it to ban the cameras altogether. Mm-hmm. That amendment failed, and so then the House passed the regulatory bill and sent it back to the Senate. So the Senate hasn't acted on the bill that we sent back because we did add a small amendment to it. So mm-hmm. right now we're kind of status quo, but Council Bluffs has not speed cameras, but they have red light cameras, and they're well regulated. The people of Council Bluffs actually don't have a problem with them, and so it was an issue that was important to my community.
So where's this going to go from here? I know that you said it had passed the House and you sent it back over to the Senate. Mm-hmm. So the Senate takes up action because it passed the funnel, right? And
well, if the Senate takes up our bill, then right. Presumably they'll accept it as we have amended it, and it will go down to the governor, or they won't, and it'll come back to us. And so we're not exactly sure where this is, yeah. is going to end.
And you think
end.
That's going to happen this week?
I don't know.
Right. It's up to them to decide.
Right, exactly.
That. Yeah. All right. Are there any bills that deal with the mental health issues in Iowa? Because we know we've been taking that up for a long, long time, too. And so I'm curious, because it's definitely an issue.
It is an issue, and I think it's an issue that's important to Iowans across the state. Yes, the House did pass the mental health bill that really expands on the community-based mental health services that we have in this state, really trying to put some of the control back in the hands of caregivers, because after all, we are dealing with a medical issue here, mm-hmm. Trying to provide services that are closer to people's homes so that they're not, you know, having to be driven by sheriff's deputies or law enforcement long distances across the state, and really getting rid of that cap on subacute beds. So subacute meaning care that isn't quite as intensive, and so individuals can be treated at a lower level of care if that's what their situation requires. And so I'm particularly interested in this issue, and I'm very, very glad that we have taken this step to pass this legislation. It did pass the House, it has passed a Senate committee, and I look forward to it becoming law as a first step in really trying to strengthen our mental health services across the state.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, I'm not an expert in mental health, but I would say that I don't think people realize how big an issue this is, how big a problem this is, both statewide and nationally.
It is, and it touches every family, whether you experience it in your own personal family, you have a neighbor, a friend, someone, you know, who goes to your church, whatever. And it, you know, I think we've seen with the recent shootings across the country that oftentimes there is a mental health component there. And so clearly it's, you know, these are some of our most vulnerable citizens who need our help. And I'm really, really encouraged that we have passed this legislation. And I know that we need to continue to do more, and especially do more for children. But this is a good first step.
I'm just curious on that, and I don't want to belabor the point on that mental health, but so do you think it's been with us for a long time and we're just now recognizing it, or do you think that our society is just kind of creeping into that a little bit and we haven't got our arms around it?
I think it's a little bit of both. I think that for many, many years there was a stigma associated with mental health issues, and I think that, 50 years ago, if you had a mental health issue or you had a child who had a mental health issue, that child was maybe kept at home. That child was not part of the mainstream of society, and a lot of folks really didn't talk about the issues. I think we've really improved as a society in addressing the fact that it is a medical condition, mm-hmm. and so that's a good thing, and there's still work to be done. But also the prevalence of drugs and affects, I think, some level of mental health issues as well. So it's a combination, I would say.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for that. What legislation has been particularly interesting for you this year in this session?
Well, it's interesting that you segue into that, because there was a bill, I sit on the Education Committee, and there was a bill that we passed out of that committee which required training across the state for school professionals to recognize the signs of suicide in our students in K through 12, specifically the upper grades. And on that day that the House Education Committee passed that bill, I was not at the committee because I was actually in Maryland attending the funeral of a relative, who 16-year-old, who had committed suicide. Mm. So that issue is incredibly personal for me. We passed the bill on the House floor earlier, and I'm very pleased that we did, because I think that we need more and more people to understand what the potential signs are of a young person who might be contemplating suicide, and what better place, to have that training with our teachers and our education officials who spend so much time with our children.
Yeah. I have two young sons, and you worry about what kind of pressure that they have to deal with, in today's society. And you're right. I mean, you have to look for the signs, because kids have a lot of pressure on them.
They do. And I think perhaps more than when I or you and I were growing up, I think there are a lot of, whether it's, the influence of social media and just a lot of pressures that we didn't have to deal with,
right,
as young people. And clearly it's alarming, because it is the number one and number two cause of death for our young people aged 16 to 20 or 21, I believe.
Right.
So it's something we all need to be.
Yeah. Well, I applaud you for being interested in that and taking the lead on that. I know that you also sit on the Veterans Affairs Committee. Has there any interesting legislation been done there?
Well, this was kind of I don't know if I want to call it a fun piece, but it was a bill that I floor managed, and it actually came to us from the National Guard, from General Orr. He asked for the authority to be able to contract with private companies and private individuals to bring services onto the base for the welfare and morale of the troops and of our men and women serving there. So, for instance, he now, because we have passed this legislation, he now is able to contract with, let's say, a barber or a hair and beauty
stylist,
yes, or a food truck, exercise opportunities, all of which are at no expense to the state. They would be, have to meet, of course, certain security,
sure,
provisions and so forth. And but it would save, a soldier having to one of our servicemen having to leave base just to get a haircut or to grab a sandwich, so I've had actually a number of our members who serve with the National Guard come up and say thank you, for allowing, mm-hmm, food trucks on base.
Yeah.
And it seems, odd that he would not have had that authority, but he needed that authority from us, and so that was kind of a fun, fun bill.
That is. That's nice that you can do that kind of thing. The status of the budget process, I mean, that's our big one, right? That's the one that you, the big thing that you have left in the legislature this year. So can you kind of go through that with us? And
sure. Well, this last week was the second funnel week, which means that the committees have, other than Ways and Means and Appropriations, the committees have pretty much finished their work, and the bills that are going to move forward have all been determined. So now we go headstrong into the budget work, and once the budget number overall is determined, then those the individual budget subcommittees, whether it be education, economic growth, human services, will all start working within their individual budgets to come up with the pieces of what will become the larger budget.
Now, I know that you're I know that you are the chair of the economic development for the House, and I know that, I don't know how much has gone through that, but I think economic development in general is such an important issue for our state, I mean, for growth and economic development projects. So, you know, you, do you want to give me a little of your philosophy on economic development, or?
Well, sure, and we have, I have been chair since 2013, we have passed a lot of really great legislation, many of them tax credit programs to help our businesses across the state, either to entice them to come into the state or to help our existing businesses grow and expand. One of the most notable bills was a couple of years ago when we passed a tax credit for Iowa businesses that would produce renewable chemicals from biomass feedstock. And that, of course, would reduce our dependence on oil, because these chemicals could be used to make things such as chemicals and plastics and that kind of thing. And so we've also taken time in our committee to revise some of our tax credits. I know sometimes tax credits can get a lot of blame for the budget woes and so forth, but we have a very tightly run program for tax credits in this state under the direction of Debbie Durham, who's the Director of Economic Development. And anyone who's receiving any kind of a tax credit, and they have to benefit the state as a whole. And so we've taken time in our committee to revise some bills, streamline them, make them competitive based instead of first come, first serve.
Right.
And, you know, they are of a benefit to our state in helping build our economy.
Well, we appreciate that, too, because we know that Iowa has been a successful state. I just think that there's some additional opportunity. We can go out and bring companies into our state and make our economy and our state better. So I'm going to just ask you a quick question. We're about out of time. So do you think that this has been a successful session up there at the State House this year? It seems like it's been a lot calmer this year.
It has a bit. You know, we started out with water quality, of course, which had its own controversy around it. But it has been, I think, you know, we're not done yet. So, you know, we've got a few more weeks to go. You never know what might happen. But clearly, you know, we are striving to you know, meet the needs of Iowans as best we can.
All right. Thank you very much for here. I learned a lot, and I hope our viewers will learn a lot. Representative Marianne Hanusa from Council Bluffs, we appreciate your time this morning.
Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you.
Appreciate it.
And that does another edition of Capital Preview. Thank you very much for tuning in.